أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الناس إنا خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى وجعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل لتعارفوا إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم إن الله عليم خبير.
صدق الله العليم. This is the verse that Allah Ta'ala says that He created you from male and female. He created you into tribes and nations so that you may know one another. So, inshallah, Sheikh Muhammad Mendez is going to further elaborate on this point and bring us home, bi-idhnillah, at least as it relates to the Quran and chains. Sheikh Muhammad Mendez is a spiritual activist, community imam, poet, meditation coach, and instructor of Arabic as well as esoteric sciences flowing from the Quran. He embraced Islam, the ancient religions of the prophets, following from as a result of his trip to Jerusalem at the age of 17. SubhanAllah, if you go to Jerusalem and become a Muslim, Allah got you. SubhanAllah, not any exaggeration, Allah has got you under his eye. He then specialized in Arabic at the university level and has been trained for over two decades in the classical and Islamic sciences by notable scholars and spiritual masters from around the world. Sheikh Muhammad Mendez teaches a radically non-violent, non-sectarian, non-misogynistic, and environmentally conscious approach to holistically living Islam throughout the U.S. and internationally, and has focused on sharing the rich spiritual, intellectual, and social political legacy of Muslims, Black Africa with diverse audiences. He currently lives in Atlanta, Georgia with his family, where he works as the founding director of the Society for Sacred Service, a mosque without walls, and the Ahad Institute, the African American Healing and Development, and Darul Kitab wa Hikmah, Prophetic Knowledge and Universal Wisdom Institutes. Without any further ado, I give you the spiritual activist, the imam, the scholar, my friend, Sheikh Muhammad Mendez.
Bismillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa
barakatuh. Whatever is said of good, we say ameen. Things that are good that are said about you, we treat it as a prayer, a supplication. And if there's things that are said about you that are not good, you should take it as an admonition and a purification. Alhamdulillah, mashallah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa afdalus salati wa tammu taslim ala Sayyidina wa Mawlana wa habibina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim wa barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim fil alamin innaka hamidu majid. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika an nadhil am nadhal am nazil am nuzal am nadhlim am nudlam am najhala am nujhala alay yujhala alayna. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا متقبلا يا رب العالمين. قد نوينا تعلم والتعليم والتذكر والتذكير والنف والانتفاع والإفادة والاستفادة والحث إلى كتاب الله والسنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم والدعوة إلى الخير والدلالة على الهدى ابتغاء وجه الله ومرضاته وقربه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى. We begin praising Allah and thanking Allah, the creator of all that exists, and we ask that he honor and that he exalt and grant peace to our beloved master, our leader, the one who brings tears of joy to our eyes, Muhammad, and along with his family and his companions. May Allah Ta'ala be pleased with all of them. We ask that Allah Ta'ala teach us that which will benefit us and benefit us by that which we learn, and that he increase us in actions that are accepted by him. We ask that Allah accept our intentions, and our dear teacher, Ustadha Aisha Prime has already cited and mentioned a number of beautiful, noble intentions that we should renew at this time. You know, tajdid niyyah, renewing your intentions, is from this path of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we add to that the intention to learn and to be learned from. I'm not just here to teach, I'm here to learn from you. We with the intention to benefit and be benefited from, to give benefit and to provide benefit and to receive benefit, to give advantage and to take advantage, and to remind and be reminded. And we ask that Allah accept our intention and realize the intention to call to Allah, exalted and glorious is He, and the path, the sunnah of His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to guide to that which is good and to call to guidance, seeking by that the face of Allah Ta'ala and His nearness and His reward and His satisfaction. Ameen, ameen, ameen. I wanted to begin with the recitation of some ayat before we continue from Surah Al-Qasas. بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم طاسيم تلك آيات الكتاب المبين نتلو عليك من نبأ موسى وفرعون بالحق لقوم يؤمنون إن فرعون علا في الأرض وجعل أهلها شيعا يستضعف طائفة منهم يذبح أبناءهم ويستحيي نساءهم إنه كان من المفسدين ونريد أن نمن على الذين استضعفوا في الأرض ونجعلهم أئمة ونجعلهم الوارثين ونمكن لهم في الأرض ونري فرعون وهامان وجنودهما منهم ما كانوا يحذرون وأوحينا إلى أم موسى أن أرضعيه فإذا خفت عليه فألقيه في اليم ولا تخافي ولا تحزني إنا رادوه إليك وجاعلوه من المرسلين صدق الله مولانا العظيم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والحامدين والحمد لله رب العالمين. So the meaning of what these ayat are in English, through the name of Allah, the unconditionally gracious, loving Redeemer, Tasin Mim, these are the signs of the clear book. We recite to you from the news of Moses and Pharaoh in truth for people who believe. And Dr. Bilal has already talked about, you know, reading these archetypes, these amthal of Moses and Pharaoh and the Bani Israel through our own experience, through our own reality, our own socio-historical political reality. There's a saying that for every لكل فرعون موسى ولكل مسألة علي, that for every pharaoh, meaning every generation, every time has their own pharaoh, and for every pharaoh there is a Moses. There's the Moses alayhi salatu wasalam, but every generation has at least one person, and there could be more than one, that is on the path of Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And every generation has at least one, and there could be many, as in our time, that are on the path of Pharaoh, that are on the path of the tyrant. And for every difficult issue, there's an Ali. there are always problems in every time, every generation that need to be, knots that need to be unraveled. And Allah Ta'ala, His Sunnah, His way is to always create from among us people whose bodies, whose intellects and souls rise to the challenges of the age. So we ask that Allah Ta'ala increase their number. So Allah Ta'ala says the news of Moses and Pharaoh is it's a news that informs us about our current conditions. Allah Ta'ala then says, indeed Pharaoh exalted himself in the land and made its people into factions. Right? So what Pharaoh does is he divides the people. And during our discussion, the lecture that Dr. Bilal gave last night, and today, if you were here for the first lecture, he documented how the Muslims were divided into wolves and shepherds using material benefit by the European slavers. And to this day, those who are on the path of Pharaoh divide us. They divide us into liberals and conservatives. They divide us black against white. They divide us Democrats against Republicans. They divide us Green Party against Libertarians. They divide us men against women, the young against the old, Salafis against Sufis, Sunnis against Shi'i, and so on and so on and so on and so on. And all this division is only so that Pharaoh benefits. At the end of the day, the one who benefited from the Africans, the Muslims who were selling each other into slavery as a survival mechanism, as Dr. Bilal so eloquently showed us yesterday and today, the one who benefited were the slavers. And the ones who benefit from our theological and doctrinal and jurisprudential and religious divisions. Disagreement need not lead to division. Disagreement need not lead to division. Are those who follow the path of Pharaoh in this time, let there be light. Oppressing a sector among them, slaughtering their sons and letting their women live, right? Because the sons were allowed to live, but the women, the sons were killed and slaughtered, but the women were allowed to live so that they could be a benefit to Pharaoh. And we see the same thing in our communities today, especially in the African American communities, especially in the Latino communities. You see boys whose creativity, whose promise is suffocated if they're allowed to live. And women who are the political and the economic apparatus of this country and other countries enables them to flourish amongst all the darkness and the chaos so that they can be a benefit to the social order. And this should not cause men and women to fight each other again. But it's so that we're aware of the systems and the technique of the oppressors. Allah Ta'ala is teaching us all of this in Surah Al-Qasas, the 28th chapter of the Quran. And then Allah Ta'ala mentions, and keeping indeed he was of the corruptors. And then this is what I want to underscore. Allah Ta'ala mentions, and it says in many translations, and I've looked at 10, maybe 15 different translations. Most of them translate this ayah in the past tense. But Allah says, وَنُرِيدُ أَنَّمُنَّ. But we are willing. It's in the present tense. But the way many of the people who interpret the Quran translate it is in the past tense. This is a mistake. It says, and I'm just reading the translation, and we wanted to confer favor upon those who were oppressed in the land and make them leaders and make them inheritors. And this is what I'm going to be talking about today. What Allah Ta'ala, the meaning of what Allah says, if you translate the tenses as they are, is that, and we will, we are willing to bless those who are oppressed. Our will, the divine will, like all of Allah Ta'ala's attributes, are uncreated, eternal without beginning, everlasting without end, not subject to change, and not like the attributes of creatures. His divine will, unchanging, immutable will, is connected to blessing those who are oppressed in any land. And he says, and to make them its imams, to make them the leaders in that land, to make them a'imma in that land, and to make them from its inheritors. So here we have three promises from Allah Ta'ala to those who are the subjects of oppression. And as we learned earlier from our dear beloved Dr. Bilal, when Allah Ta'ala wishes to confer favor upon you, He delivers you to the hands of your enemies. That might not sound all warm and fuzzy, but that is the sunnah of Allah. When He wills, not wishes, because Allah does not wish, subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Allah wills to confer favor upon you, He delivers you to the hands of your enemies, as He did to our father Adam, alayhi salam, as He did to Prophet Ibrahim, alayhi salam, as He did to Prophet Yusuf, as He did to Isa, as He did to Musa, as he did to Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi salam. And we can go on and on and on and on and on. So Allah Ta'ala blesses with making those who are oppressed imams and those who are oppressed inheritors. And the greatest inheritance is the inheritance of prophethood. The inheritance of prophethood. And then the meaning is, and establish them in the land and show Pharaoh. And to establish them in the land and show Fir'aun and their and his ministers, Haman and the soldiers from those who are oppressed, who are on the side, not of Allah, not of Musa, but they're on the side of Pharaoh. That there are people from among the oppressed who are getting paid for whatever material benefit they're seeking, that are not on the side of Musa alayhi salam. They're not on the side of the prophets. They are not from Hizbillah. They're from Hizb al-Shaytan. They're from the party of Satan. And Allah's will is to show Pharaoh and Haman, his minister, and to show the soldiers, the armies, that are from the oppressed but not supporting the oppressed, what they fear. And what is it that they fear? They fear to lose leadership, to lose control. They fear to lose wealth. They fear the eminence of those people that they are oppressing. And what we've been talking about is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again and again and again in human history, causes those who are subjugated to rise through the Quran, through revelation. We're talking about liberation through revelation. And then Allah says in the last ayah, and this goes back to women, and we revealed to the mother of Moses. We don't know anything about the father of Moses. But we know a lot about the mother of Moses. And we revealed to the mother of Moses, meaning we inspired her to nurse him. And when you're afraid, do what? When you fear for him, what should you do? Hold him tight. Alqihi fil yam. Throw him in the river. That's absolutely the last thing a mother wants to do. But this is from the Lord of the worlds. This is not our law. This is not man-made logic. And then Allah says, وَلَا تَخَافِي وَلَا تَحْزَنِي. Do not fear and do not grieve. And these two are the greatest obstacles on our path to getting closer to Allah. Our fear and our grief. And all throughout the Quran, Allah says to different prophets and different righteous, لَا تَخَافِي. لا تخاف لا تحزن. Don't be afraid and don't grieve. Fear is related to your anxiety about the future. And grief is related to your pain. The grief is related to your pain about what was lost in the past. So don't fear for the future of this boy and don't have sorrow over losing him. And each and every one of us, with the exception of a few, have fears. And we have grief. Some of us are afraid of the dark. Some of us are afraid of mice. Oh, he threw under the bus. Some of us are afraid of the criticism of others. Some of us are afraid of poverty. Some of us are afraid of sickness. Some of us are afraid of death. Whatever your fear is, it is blocking you from Allah. Some of us are afraid that people we love are going to die on other than Islam. Not concerned, you're afraid. It paralyzes you. And some of us are grieving. We're grieving over lost friends and family. We're grieving over lost dreams and ambitions. We're grieving over lost status, money, lost opportunities. There's so many things we grieve about. Relationships. لا تحزني لا تخافي ولا تحزني. Don't have any fear and don't grieve. And in this time that we're in, this era of Trump, a lot of fear and a lot of grief was unleashed. November 8th it was, right? Whatever day the election was, a lot of fear and a lot of grief was unleashed during the campaign in this past year. Allah says, and we are going to return him to you. Indeed, we will return him to you. And we're going to make him from among those who are messengers. So this, my beloveds, these are principles. That those who are oppressed should have absolute confidence. If you have faith, if you're from those who have faith, you should have absolute confidence that if you are oppressed, whether you are an African American, or whether you are Palestinian, or whether you are Kurdish, or whether you are Basque, or whether you're from Ulster in Northern Ireland, or whether you're from Kashmir, or whether you're Dalits, whatever group you're in that is oppressed, there's a promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to you. And with this history that we're about to look at, is a chronicle of how Allah ta'ala took a people who symbolized to Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu anhu, Ibn Rabah, who was, when we meet him, he is oppressed. He is being tortured. And it is through his faith, and it is through his character, and it is through his devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his devotion to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he gains freedom through the intervention of Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. And ultimately he rises to become one of the closest companions to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At the beginning, as I was saying yesterday in the khutbah, at the beginning we see him with a boulder on his, crushing his chest and the sands burning his skin. But at the end, towards the end of the prophetic mission, the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we see him with his feet over the Kaaba. And don't think that Allah ta'ala was honoring him by giving him this honor of standing on the Kaaba. Rather, Allah was honoring the Kaaba by the feet of Bilal. Because as Sidi Bilal said, Allah loves humans. Allah loves human beings who embody akhlaq that Allah loves. Allah loves the people who purify themselves. Allah loves the people who repent. Allah loves people who are just. Allah loves people who trust in Him. Allah loves people who persevere. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves these people. And so Allah ta'ala took Bilal and made him who He made him. We are looking at, okay, bismillah. So what you can see up here, these are pictures of masajid in West Africa, in Songhai, what later became Mali, the Republic of Mali. And on the left, this is actually a letter. This is the letter that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent to the great An-Najashi, the great Negus Ashama, may Allah be pleased with him, the emperor of Ethiopia. During the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there were three major empires. And again, because of our blind spot towards black people in Africa as Muslims, we only talk about two. And the two that actually went to war against the Prophet ﷺ, we mentioned them, right? The Persian Empire and the Byzantine Roman Empire. But the other great empire at that time, it was so great that Yemen was a colony of it. That's why you meet many Yemenis today with the last name Al-Habshi, right? Was the Aksumite kingdom of ancient Ethiopia, Abyssinia, Habasha. And we're going to talk about Habasha. This is the letter. And the letter that the Prophet ﷺ sent him was not like the letter that he sent to Kisros or Heraclius or others. And we'll look at that, inshallah. So these are masajid. These are people who are rope makers. These are people who are teachers of the Quran, and this was in the city of Sudan, and this is in the city of Maiwurno in Sudan, that is known all over Sudan for Quran, for teaching Quran. And what you find, what Dr. Bilal described, the system, the education system for making the Quran a part of every fiber in your body, was a system that spanned, that was in place all the way from Senegambia to Eritrea. And I've been in Nigeria, I've been in Senegal, I've been in Sudan, there's a city in Sudan called Umdoumban. Right? Many of the cities in Sudan begin with the word because means mother, right, the foundation. Umdoumban means Do Mubin, right? The mother of the clear light. It is a city that is only for teaching the Quran and the Arabic sciences and the Islamic sciences. And they've been teaching Quran there for hundreds and hundreds of years the same way, with the Loa. They call it Umdoumban because there's a fire that they keep burning for the students to use at nighttime. And even though they have electricity now, they still keep that fire burning and they read Quran at that fire, right? And when they clean their loh, they let the water run into the pit where the fire is, right? And I remember when I went there, the Quran teacher, the sheikh had the kind of whip Indiana Jones has, right? And he would listen, like he would say, 50 students would be reciting, and he would be correcting each one. You just have to see it for yourself. This is one of my teachers, Sheikh Muhammad Sharif, who's a calligrapher, a historian, a martial artist. He was my first teacher. I was blessed to meet him a week or two after I embraced Islam. He's writing the Quran. He's writing the Quran in the Kufic, fi khat kufi, Ifriqi, in the African Kufic script. And this was something that's done and it's still preserved to this day. And these Qur'ans are sold. And if you look at the writing, it is very similar to the writing of the companion who wrote that letter to the Najashi for the Prophet ﷺ. Our dear brother Mansur read this ayah today. Inna khalaqna ba'da a'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha waja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabaila ta'arafu in aqrabakum 'inda Allahi atqakum inna Allaha 'alimun khabir. Allah Ta'ala created you from a male and a female. Why? So that you know each other. A lot of people leave that out. You're created from a male and a female so you know one another. And He created you into nations and tribes. The sha'ab and the qabila, the shu'ub and the qaba'il are social groups that share the same ancestor. We're not talking about a nation that's based on imaginary political boundaries that someone drew on a map and has you and me believing that they're real. What's real are your ancestors and the relationships of the Raham. This Raham that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Ar-Raham muta'alliq bil-arsh, that the womb is attached to the throne. Just real quick, how many women have heard this hadith before? Please raise your hand high. How many women have heard this hadith before? How many men have heard this hadith before? Hadith sahih. The womb of the woman is attached to the throne. And the scholars have written a lot about it. And Allah Ta'ala made us into these tribes and nations so that we know one another. So that I know the good that's in you and you know the good that's in me. Why are we all here today? Even if you're not African, even if you're not African American, because there are things in the African American and African experience that are virtuous and that are noble that you can benefit from. And there are things in your experience, if you are not African American, no matter where you are from, whether you are native, indigenous, American or Latino, Latina, if you're Turkish or Pakistani or Bengali or Egyptian or Sudanese or Nigerian or Chinese, wherever you're from, there's something good in your people. And there's something that I need from you. And together we complete one another. Indeed, those who are most honorable with Allah are the ones who have the most reverence for Allah. Those who are most conscious of Allah, and Allah knows all things. And Allah is intimately informed of all of them. The knowledge of Allah Ta'ala encompasses everything that was, everything that is, everything that will be, and everything that won't be had it been. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said in a hadith, Ibn Kathir relates it in other scholars of hadith, تَعَلَّمُ مِنْ أَنْسَابِكُمْ لِتَوَسُلُ بِهِ أَرْحَامِكُمْ Arhamakum, learn from your lineage. Learn from your lineage. That which will allow you to connect and honor your wombs. Yani, the kinship ties between you and others. And ultimately, as human beings, we're all from the same womb. Right? Scripture bears this out, as well as archaeological and anthropological evidence. We are all from the same womb. So learning your history is important. This is a poem that is from one of the great scholars of Timbuktu. The city of Timbuktu was known as the City of God, along with Gao and others like it, Jaga, where the Jahankir are from, because Timbuktu, which was founded by a woman, Timbuktu, what does Timbuktu mean? The well of Buktu. And also has another meaning, the place of books. Buktu was a woman who discovered a well like Hajar, alayhi salam. Just like Hajar, who was another Nubian African woman who founded the city of Mecca. You ever think about that? That Hajar alayhi salam founded the city of Mecca? If it wasn't for the well of Zamzam that Allah Ta'ala guided her to through the angel at the feet of the baby Ismail alayhi salam, no Mecca. But why don't we celebrate her as that? Why don't we remember her as that? So Buktu founded this well, and it is from that that people started to come. She was a scholar, and this is narrated in one of the books of one of my teachers, Wazira Junaid. And just for the sake of time, we'll skip to the English. I'll tell you about this woman. I put that picture there on purpose. This is all related to the Quran. So this scholar said in Wazira Junaid, Wazira Junaid is one of my teachers. I was blessed to meet him in 1995, a year before he passed. He was in his 90s. He lived in Sokoto. He was not only the prime minister of the Sultan of Sokoto, but he was a qadi. He was an Islamic judge. He was a poet. He was a linguist. He was a historian. Hunwick, Professor John Hunwick, went to visit him many times to get books from him. So he collected this in his works. Whoever does not inform his children and his grandparents of his grandparents has destroyed his child, marred his descendants, and injured his offspring the day he dies. Whoever does not make use of his ancestry has muddled his reason. Whoever is unconcerned with his lineage has lost his mind. And some of you are in my classes, you know this is something that I emphasize over and over again, right, Colin? Know from whence you came. James Baldwin. Can I quote James Baldwin in the masjid? Can I do that? Yusuf? James Baldwin said, "Know from whence you came. For if you know from whence you came, there's no limit to where you can go." And this is why knowing your lineage is so important. Not so you can pump your chest and say, "My fathers and my mothers did this." Not for tafakhur. Not for bragging and boasting. But you seek out your family tree and you climb it so you can find those people in your family tree who are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because that is the level that your lineage has established, and you as their descendant, their descendant should not go below that level. So if you had ancestors who memorized the Quran, who recited the Quran, who could write the Quran from memory, in Porokhan, a city in Senegal, there's a school just for girls and women. You don't graduate unless you, as a woman, can write your own Quran from memory. Look at that. Huh? So you, in your family tree, you look for the prophets in your family tree. And some of you are descendants of prophets. You look for the Siddiqun in your family tree. You look for the Shuhada in your family tree. You look for the Salihun in your family tree. And then that's your standard. So I'm speaking specifically here as an African to African Americans. So if Malcolm X is in your family tree, if Ella Collins is in your family tree, if Dr. Betty Shabazz is in your family tree, if Imam Worthuddin Muhammad is in your family tree, if Imam Makandal and Bukman are in your family tree, how can you do less than that? How can you do less than them? If you have Umar ibn Sayyid and Bilali Muhammad in your family tree, how can you do less than them? So each generation moves the ball further down the field. And for you not to move the ball further to touchdown, you've failed those coming after you. He says, whoever neglects his origin, his stupidity has become critical. Whoever is unaware of his ancestry, his incompetence has become immense. This was how they saw the world. And I know that we're Americans now, and what happened back home doesn't matter. Right? Some people think that way. I'm an American. But if what happened back home didn't matter, how come we're bringing the racism from back home and is destroying our communities? We're bringing the sexism from back home, the classism from back home, and so many other illnesses from back home, if where you're from doesn't matter. And why aren't we bringing the good? Many of our homelands have good in them. We should bring the good and leave the bad. But in order to do that, you have to know who you are. And then he says, whoever is ignorant of his roots, his intellect has vanished. And when you read it in Arabic on the slide, it's beautiful. Whoever does not know his place of origin, his honor has collapsed. So know your family. And when you look as a West African, as an East African, you see a tradition that was in love with the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Not the only tradition. And this woman here, her name is Sheikha Maria Minyas. You can look her up online, right? There's a beautiful documentary on her that Al Jazeera did. And she was the daughter of Sheikh Ibrahim Minyas, who was one of the greatest scholars of this ummah in the 20th century. He passed away in 1975. And it's said that he lived for 75 years. He wrote 75 books, and he had 75 children. And she said before he passed that he made her take an oath to recite the entire Quran every week for the rest of her life. When I went to Senegal, I saw a country, the 92% that you were talking about, right? And the that are spiritually inclined and affiliated, and the 99% who are Muslim, I saw people who are absolutely in love with the Quran. In the city of Touba, do you know that they recite the entire Quran 28 times every day? 28 times every day. Absolutely in love with the Book of Allah. They recite it, they memorize it, they write it, they drink it, right? They wear it. Right? And she said in that interview that since that day in 1975, not one week has gone by in my life that I have not recited the entire Quran. I never broke my oath to my father. And she has a school in Dakar where girls and boys are trained in the sciences of the Quran, in the sciences of Arabic, and in the advanced sciences of the deen. All right, subhanAllah. May Allah bless her. And that picture, and I want to show this, you see this man is coming to her, asking her to pray for him. And this is something that is beautiful for men to recognize women of scholarship and righteousness. I'm going to skip this. We'll save that for tonight. It's from Sheikh Anta Job. So if you want to hear what Sheikh Anta Job has to say about some of this, come to the America's Islamic Heritage Museum. Tell you. Bismillah. So Dr. Bilal spoke about the Habashis, the Abyssinians. And there are at least 9 books that I know of written by Muslim scholars about the merits of the Ahbash, of the Abyssinians. At least 9. I have 2 of them in my collection. The one by Ibn al-Jawzi, Abdurrahman Ibn al-Jawzi, Rahmatullah alayh, the great Hanbali scholar, and the one by Imam al-Suyuti. The one by Ibn al-Jawzi is called Tanwir al-Ghabash fi Fadli Sudan wal-Habash. And just in case you're wondering, Ibn al-Jawzi was not Abyssinian. He was Iraqi. He was Arab. And he wrote this book the illumination of darkness. And there's an abridgment of it on the table back. Please see the table back there to purchase Dr. Bilal's book if you don't have it. He did not ask me to say that. And to see the books I have on display. Illuminating the Darkness by Habib Akande is there. And it's taken from Ibn al-Jawzi's book. Ibn al-Jawzi wrote this book, Illuminating the Darkness, regarding the virtue of the blacks and of the Abyssinians. Based on the Quran, based on the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and the sayings of the Salaf, as-Salih. Imam al-Suyuti has a book called Rafu Sha'n al-Hubshan, raising the affair of the Abyssinians. Why did these scholars expend their ink and their intellectual knowledge on this matter? Because there's a medicine in it for us and for you. So these are from Imam al-Suyuti's book. Jahid has a book, right? You used to be able to find at most black bookstores back in the day. Right, the glorious black race. Anyone remember that yellow book? Tayyib. So the Habashis are a famous people, Imam An-Nawawi says, whose lineage goes to Ham bin Nuh. And this is what Imam An-Nawawi says in his book, Tahdhib al-Asma wal-Lughat, the refining, the rarefaction of names and languages, that the Abyssinians are the majority of humanity. This is Imam An-Nawawi. Sahib al-Minhaj, Riyad al-Salihin, 40 Hadith al-Nawawi, and on and on and on. Shar Sahih Muslim, right? He says the Abyssinians are the majority of humanity, and their land is the largest of the lands. And I put this here because a lot of times we think of Abyssinia just as some of us think it's the country Ethiopia, right? Which it was not during the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Just like Yemen today was not the Yemen during the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Sham today is not the Sham as we knew it during the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And it's the largest of lands, Imam An-Nawawi says. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam relates the caliphate is from the Quraysh, the judiciary is from the Ansar, and the invitation of the Adhan is from the blacks. This is the division of labor he established in Medina. Right? That these groups took priority. And again, it's important to understand that he was talking here about lineage because by our standards today, most of the Quraysh during the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and the Ansar would be considered black. Just to drive my point home, Abu Dharr al-Ghifari, radiallahu anhu, Ali bin Abi Talib, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Allah be pleased with all of them, are all described the same way that Bilal is described. Adim Shadid al-Udma. So don't think that blacks here is like the Arabs. Yani most of them were black or dark skinned. Yani Asmar and Aswad and Adim. The problem, this is Sidi Bilal already mentioned the hadith that's I'm quoting here from Ibn Kathir in Al-Bidayah wa Nihaya. Hold to the blacks. The Prophet ﷺ said, hold to the blacks. Ittakhadu Sudan. Like, hold on to them. Ibn Kathir relates this in Al-Bidayah wa Nihaya. Rahmatullah alayh. Hold on to the blacks. Because three persons from them are from the masters of the people of paradise. Luqman al-Hakim, al-Najashi, and Bilal al-Mu'adhin. May Allah be pleased with them. And according to, we all know, well, we should know that Luqman was from Abyssinia. The scholars of Tafsir say that he was the cousin of Prophet Dawud alayhi salam. Yes. And there's a difference of opinion about whether he was a prophet or a non-prophet. Right? Ikrima and Sha'bi say that he was a prophet. And Allah Ta'ala knows best. What we do know is that there's a surah named after him. And all the suwar, all the chapters of the Quran that have the named after human beings are named after prophets. Except if you take the position that they weren't prophets, Surah Maryam and Surah Luqman. Right? Maryam like that. Right? Maryam ad-Dabbagh. Tayyib. So I'm going to go over this tonight. Okay, so Bismillah. I'm going to go over this later, inshallah. That was about Mihja. Tayyib. Original, okay. This is the letter of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Okay, Tayyib. So this is what I want to go into. All I want to say, you know, I kind of skipped over the letter of the Prophet ﷺ to An-Najashi, but this began a new dispensation. If you study sacred history, if you study religious history, if you look at the history of prophethood, you'll see that the Africans, and this goes back to the Quran being in chains, the Africans were historically, and I don't want to romanticize things. Pharaoh was an African, right? Now there's difference of opinion about which Pharaoh, because there are people who came from outside Egypt who took the title of Pharaoh. The Mufassirun talk about all of this, but let's just accept Pharaoh was African. So I don't want to paint this picture that Africans are all salihun, and there's Africans have salih and Africans have talih. There are Africans that are righteous and Africans that are corrupt. Let's just get that out of the way. I'm not trying to romanticize anything. But if you look at the history of African people, they have historically served as a refuge for the prophets and the messengers. Historically, you can look at Prophet Musa alayhi salam. You can look at Prophet Ibrahim in his seerah, Prophet Yusuf in his seerah, Prophet Yaqub in his seerah. There's even accounts of Sayyidina Isa and Sayyidina Maryam going to Africa alayhi salatu wasalam, and of course our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, even though we don't have any historical record that he himself went to Abyssinia, he sent his daughter Ruqayya, who was married to Uthman, right? Yes, and his last wife, Maria Akuptia. It's African. So you always see Africa. This is the historic, and again, I'm saying this so that, 5 minutes.
Yes.
I'm saying this so that we understand the precedent that was set by our ancestors as being a refuge for revelation. And we cannot let that end in this time. So this letter is a letter of tremendous love. The Prophet ﷺ is calling Asham al-Najashi to Islam, and he bears witness to Isa, Jesus Christ, peace and blessings be upon him, and his mother, being servants of Allah. And when you look at the response of al-Najashi, it is so beautiful. A lot of us know about the letter that the Prophet ﷺ sent to An-Najashi, but we don't know about the letters that Najashi sent back to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they were letters of tremendous love. And this is why when he passed away, he said, our brother has passed, and he prayed the janazah in absentia. Tayyib. So this began a new dispensation in the relationship between Africans and revelation. Again, these are manuscripts, and these are different cities that all of them were places where the Quran, these are cities and empires, Timbo, Masina, Mali, Timbuktu, Kano, where I had the blessing to visit. Islam has been there for almost 1,000 years, if not more. The central mosque, not the only mosque, the central mosque in Kano, Nigeria, Jumu'ah, 50,000 people. That's like Super Bowl, Right? That's every week. Every week. Every Ramadan, between Asr and Maghrib, people study the tafsir of Sheikh Abdullah Danfodio, Diyat Ta'wil, that's in the back there. You can look at it. Which is unique, because it is a tafsir that, these are all manuscripts written on the sciences of Islam and taken from the Quran and the Hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It's a tafsir that gathers all the four madahib, that gathers all the 10 qira'ats that are mashhur. It gathers the nuances of the Arabic language. It gathers in it points of aqidah, and it's amazing. Amazing, amazing. And how did the Diyat Ta'wil get written? Sheikh Abdullah Danfodio, who was a scholar who was committed to the Book of Allah. He wrote two tafsirs on the Quran. Diya Ta'wil fi Ma'ani Tanzil, the light of interpretation regarding the meanings of the revelation. And when people said, this is a bit too difficult for us, he wrote Kifat Du'afa As-Sudan. The sufficiency of the weak-minded from the blacks. He was a Fulani scholar, right? He wrote books. He took the Itqan. How many of you know the Itqan of Imam Suyuti? Al-Itqan by Imam Suyuti is a, it's like an encyclopedia of Ulum al-Quran. He took the Itqan and versified it into a poem. So he wrote, yeah, alhamdulillah. Anyway, so the commitment of these people to the Book of Allah Ta'ala was mind-boggling. His niece, Sheikha Asma, Nana Asma bin Fodio, she has poems that she wrote. She knew five languages. And she would write in Hausa, Fulani, and Arabic. She wrote in three languages. And she has a poem that she wrote on the medicine of the Quran, right? And we have to understand that the Africans that were being brought here during the European slave trade, they were people who knew these books. The Wathika of Sheikh Uthman Nafodio was found in the Caribbean. And I just want to end with talking about one of these people, all right? So there's Ayub bin Suleiman and Yaro Mahmoud, and you know, who lived not far from here. But I want to talk about one in particular who has really inspired me, and he's not known. So the Haitian revolution that Dr. Bilal was talking about, that really preceded the French Revolution. Like, the French like to make every, like, just like our brothers and sisters who are Jewish want the world to think that they gave the world monotheism, right? When you have records of monotheism in ancient Egypt, don't let anyone lie to you that all the ancient Egyptians were mushrikun. Even Allah tells you that there was a man from the family of Fir'aun who was hiding his faith. Yes or no? The French and the Americans want you to believe that they gave democracy and liberty and these ideals to the world. But before the French Revolution, before the American Revolution, there was a revolution that began in Haiti in 1752 that was started by a Muslim. And I know if you look him up, Macandal was his name. Macandal is a city in the Congo. He led this Muslim. You'll look him up and you'll find debates. Was he Muslim or not? But I've spoken to Haitian scholars and I've done research of my own. And what all the historians agree upon is that when he was captured at the age of 12 from Africa, he was already fluent in Arabic. He had memorized the Quran. Sylvain Joff, in her book Servants of Allah, devotes about three pages at least to Macandal. And she mentions that he was so successful, he was so distinguished in not only the sciences of Islam, but in art, in mathematics, in music, that he must have been from either at least a noble family or a descendant of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This 12-year-old boy, according to Haitian oral tradition, allowed himself to be captured because he had a vision that he would bring freedom to those who were enslaved in the West. And he was brought in chains at the age of 12. And like Dr. Bilal said yesterday, they had a machine going. They expected 3 years, 7 years max, you're dead. We'll get new Africans to fuel the machine. Right. Macandal escaped and he established a community of Maroons, right? Maroons in the mountains of Haiti. Now, we hear, and I know my time is up, but I'll close on this. We know about the, you know, we've heard of field slaves, right? I don't like to call them slaves. I call them captured Africans or enslaved Africans, right? Please take this out of your language, right? Calling those Africans that were brought here, just calling them slaves. And we do the same thing with Bilal ibn Rabah radiallahu anhu. We always say Bilal, the former slave. But we don't say that about Salman al-Farsi. Do we say that about Salman? I did a search myself. I looked up Bilal, slave. I looked up Salman al-Farsi, I didn't see anything. That's not the first thing they tell you. I looked up Suhaib al-Rumi, he was a slave too. But we don't, it's not his middle name. The way it is with Bilal. Bilal, former slave, the Abyssinian. Right. Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, wasn't he a former slave? Wasn't he sold into slavery? Do we go around saying Prophet Yusuf the former slave? Why is it with Bilal? We have to say that. And one of our sisters asked about healing the racism. There's a book on the table there that Ustad Aisha helps me to teach called Liberation Therapy. And it is a transpersonal development system for healing trauma. Because the racism that's in our community is caused by the trauma of colonization and of the European American slave trade. And that book, Liberation Therapy, is key to helping us become post-racial, to use those words, to heal, become whole, to return to our fitrah, where we look at two children, black and white, that are 2 years old or less, playing together. They don't interact with each other based on their color of their skin. They just see a soul, right? So Makandal used his knowledge of the Quran to unite, and I want to end on this, to unite not only the Africans of Haiti, who had many different religions. Some of them were Muslim, some of them were Christian, some were mixing what they could and practicing Vodun. Some of them practiced ancestral African religions. And he united the Arawak and the Taino that hadn't been killed yet, right? The French killed a million Arawak and Taino natives in 50 years. But Makandal united everyone using his knowledge of the Quran. He broke the shackles. And he began in 1752 a process that culminated in the Haitian Revolution of 1801, January 1st, that led to the independence ultimately. Imam Bukman, who came after him, why did the French call him Bukman? Because they say Bukman was from Jamaica, and he was a Maroon in Jamaica, who was, you know, teaching people that they were born to be free, not to be slaves. And so the English ran him out of Jamaica, and he went to Haiti, the island of Hispaniola. And then when he got there, he continued what Makandal started. And they called him Bukman because they say he always had a Quran with him. Dutty Bukman. He always had a Quran. So if you're a revolutionary, if you're an activist, if you think you're going to somehow defeat the man, and you're not reciting the Quran at night and living it during the day, you're kidding and fooling yourself. Because the only people who've been successful are the people whose hearts and tongues and minds are attached to the Quran, have been illuminated by the Quran. And they were sick. So we know about Toussaint Louverture, we know about Dessalines, but they don't tell you about Bukman, they don't tell you about Makandal. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So I ask that Allah Ta'ala make us people of the Quran. I ask that Allah Ta'ala heal our shackles. That Allah break the fetters that bind us, the fear and the grief through the Quran. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى وسلم وسلم. جزاكم الله خيرا. Forgive me for being long. والحمد لله رب العالمين.
Takbir!
Allahu
Akbar! Takbir!
Allahu Akbar! Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. I know you said you should be. The final liberation, inshallah, from 6 to 10 at the Islamic Heritage Museum. I don't know about you, but that left me like, I need some more. I need more. So, but we did cover, alhamdulillah wa shukurillah, we covered the Quran in chains. I want to, and this part is extremely significant, the last statement that he just said, and that is, If we think that we're going to be active, that we're going to free our communities from the colonizers, from that which seeks to oppress us, if we think that we're going to rise above the system as Muslims, but we're not connected to the Quran, then we're kidding ourselves. And this is, I just want to express this point really quickly, because it's 5 o'clock. Why is that so significant? Because many times we as Americans and people who come to America from other places think that America is offering something better than Islam. We think that there is a democracy outside of Islam that's better than what we have. We think there is a feminism outside of Islam that is better than what we have. We think there is a healing in different movements that is better than what we have. And what these two men came to teach us is that what we have itself. But if you don't hold tight to it, in second we can tap the cool. If you don't hold tight to it with strength, then you're weak. And your movements will fall apart and will continue to break rank. And we're looking at each other with some silly and crooked mouth. What are we gonna do next? How are we gonna fix it? What's the next thing Trump gonna say that's gonna make us fall apart? Hold tight to this book. This Quran is no joke. Our Lord is no joke. Allahu al-Qawi. Allahu al-Muhammad. And all this running to and fro between what this lawyer is going to say, what this legislator is going to do. Oh my God, we're on the Chicken Little syndrome. The sky is falling, the sky is falling. Allahu Akbar. It is not our concern that we're thinking, that's okay, Allah is going to fix it. That's okay, Allah's got my back. Allah does not send you tests so you can see what Allah is going to do. Allah sends you a test so you can see what you're going to do. Don't come to these programs and say, wow, that was enlightening. I'm proud to be black. I'm proud to be a Muslim. I'm going to hold on to them black people. Put the black people in the front, I got you from the back. That's not what that means. That's not what that means. Recite the Quran at night, stand firm in the day. And don't break ranks. Don't break rank. Don't break rank. What they have is weak. What they have is weak. And this Quran is the truth. On that, jazakallah khair, forgive me. Sorry, I came up. For that, actually, I'm going to pass the mic to Imam Johari to close this out. Barakallah fikum. Wasalam.
Need a little water to wash my hands. Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam Rasulil Kareem. I have to say on behalf of the Dar Hijra Islamic Center, because maybe there's some people who think Or the reason that we're having this program is because Johari is black. Yeah, just think that. Johari, that's why, right? Or Aisha Prime, because she's black, that's why we have this program. Mm-hmm. That might be true. But this program was organized by the Youth Department of Dar Hijra in conjunction with the Education Department of Dar Hijra. And they asked in the Education Committee, what are you going to do this year for Black History Month? Because it's a part of the history that we as Muslims lack. We didn't go to them begging, oh, Dar Hijra, please, we need to have resources so we can do. They said, we have to have this program. We had a Dr. Abdullah Hakeem Quick before. We had Amin Nathari before. What are we gonna do now? So I want you to know that this is not like some type of aberration. It is a part of the program. But I cannot thank Sister Aisha Prime and Muhammad Kibria for their leadership in this program. And especially, do you notice this program has a little more beauty, not because you're sitting here, that has more beauty than we usually have. Did you notice that? Did you notice that the food is a little better than the food we usually have? And we have some beautiful volunteers, alhamdulillah. If the volunteers will stand up. Some of them are still somewhere working, but the beautiful adab, the etiquette, the beauty that they brought to this program, alhamdulillah, is an honor and credit to our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I want to say just in closing that maybe some people might say that this is a kind of a new Dar Hijra. Who would say that? Anybody? Kind of a new Dar Hijra? You know you're being videotaped, you know they don't. I would say to you, probably you're wrong. Then what this is your Dar Hijra. And it's the reason that it is now is because of you. That means, alhamdulillah, you need to continue. Stop saying, oh, Dar Hijra, you know how they are. This is your Dar Hijra. And alhamdulillah, you need to claim it. You need to support it. That means you need to spend money. Now, if Muhammad Kibria was here, he would say, you have to follow us on social media. Yeah. This program is being streamed live, am I right? So that means it not only is for the benefit of people who are here, but the message that is happening here is going all around the world. Bismillah, this is your message. Come here, learn, study, pray. Don't just come to, oh, they're having a special program. This message is open, wallahi, for Fajr. Everyone who prays Fajr here, anybody here pray Fajr? How many people here for Fajr, Shaykh? I count about 200 people pray here? Every Fajr. If you live near here, you need to get here. And if you don't live near here, you might want to think about moving. So that you can live near the house of Allah. Brothers and sisters, I want to thank you all. Don't forget, alhamdulillah, tonight, almost by the time you just pray Maghrib, you go straight to the America's Islamic Heritage Museum in the most dangerous part of Washington. Because black people still live there. Paul Anacostia. Huh? Oh, yeah, you actually, this is Ward 8. Only black people left are really in Ward 7. But wallahi, if you've never been to America's Islamic Heritage Museum. You need to get there.
Tonight.
Yeah, thank you, Allah. Tonight. We ask Allah to have mercy on you and your family. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to continue to bless us, God. Allah, help us, alhamdulillah, that as those who lead, that we might follow them in all that is good. Allah, we ask for the blessing, alhamdulillah, on this house, on all of the houses of Allah, on all of the scholars of Islam, on all of those who say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. Allah, help us that we might open our hearts, subhanAllah, to reach out to our friends and our neighbors, that they might be guided, alhamdulillah, to the best of Allah's guidance. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on us and our children. Allah, join our hearts together in love for you and love for each other. Allah, we ask, alhamdulillah, for those who, alhamdulillah, suffer with difficulties, ya Allah. Allah, that you might lift the burden, alhamdulillah, to bless them through their masiba, through their difficulty, alhamdulillah. That you might join our hearts together, alhamdulillah, in the commitment to nothing except la ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. That you might have mercy on us in this life. And grant us the best in your hereafter, and your mercy and your peace on all of your Nabis and Rasul, alhamdulillah, and those who follow them until the day of judgment. Amen.